Hi there. Today we'll learn about energy diagrams and how they can help us understand the motion of a system qualitatively. Energy diagrams are graphs showing potential energy against the position of a system. They're really useful for demonstrating an object's motion, as well as determining other things, like, for example, what an object's motion would look like if the motion continued. Imagine that a block with mass m is placed at rest on a frictionless surface at the equilibrium position of the spring, x equals 0. Now, if you stretch that spring rightwards by a distance x max, using an external force, and then release the block will move leftwards according to the spring force Fs. You get a neat sproing, but you also get a motion that you can measure and use in a bunch of different ways. Let's look at some math to help understand what's happening here. The potential energy of the spring block system is a function of the position of the block, given here by Us. The potential energy is equal to half of the spring constant K, multiplied by the position of the block squared. We can use this to construct a graph for change in potential energy, drawing it against the position of the block X along the x-axis of the graph. Now, because a spring is a spring, the spring constant is the measure of how much it compresses or expands, and therefore how it will move after the external force is removed. For a given energy E, the spring block system will oscillate between two points, negative X max and positive X max. The spring, like any object in oscillating motion, won't ever go past the turning points that we can see on this graph. You may have seen an experiment where a professor hangs a bowling ball from a rope attached to the ceiling. They lift the bowling ball to their face and release it. You expect the ball to come back and hit them, but it never does, because it can only swing as far as the potential energy invested in it from the beginning, namely the height from which you release the bowling ball. The same thing happens with this spring block system. In general, at rest, the system is in a stable equilibrium. If left alone, the spring block system will settle into somewhere where there is a net zero force. The minimum position of the block, Us, then, is zero. This is a stable equilibrium because it needs an external force to take it up to E before it will spring. Now consider an energy diagram for a block moving under the influence of a conservative force. When the equilibrium is at the maximum point, it has an unstable equilibrium because all the potential energy is in it. It only needs the tiniest bit of an external force to move it from the maximum point. The last common type of energy diagram is a neutral equilibrium. This is evident when the potential energy is constant over a region. This diagram, for example, could be illustrating a block being pushed along a smooth, flat table. It's unlikely to move back to its starting position on its own, right? It's important to note here that we've been looking at energy diagrams where the potential energy is a gravitational potential. This isn't always the case, and therefore energy diagrams aren't always linear, nor always a graph of kinetic energy. As such, don't forget that these aren't usual graphs where the x-axis is equal to time, so a point further to the right doesn't indicate a later position in time, but simply a different amount of energy relative to the position within the system. Let's look at an example to help us better learn how to use energy diagrams. This graph shows the potential energy curve of atoms in a molecule. Give an approximate value for the equilibrium separation. As we know, the stable equilibrium exists at the minimum potential energy. Because this graph goes down and then back up, the stable equilibrium of separation between the atoms should be the lowest point in this graph. We can plot a line to the x-axis from the lowest point in this graph and approximate the equilibrium point to be around 3 times 10 to the negative 10 meters. This should have given you a good foundation in energy diagrams and how you can use them to assess equilibrium points in systems. To help you lock all this in, find other physics resources on our website and do some practice questions. See you next time!